Hey guys, welcome to episode 62 of The Green Life. In today's episode, I'm interviewing a friend of mine, Stephanie Jeffs Lamerton, who is the founder of Explore Raw. Now, Stephanie is amazing. She has so much to share, and we talk about her journey from the beginning of a career, for going from a corporate career into Explore Raw, and then the struggles in the last few years, and how she's picking her health back up again. Now, before I give you more details, a huge thank you to Namawell for the J2 juicer. The J2 has been an upgrade to my juicing experience, and I really love it. I cannot tell you how beautiful it is to have a machine that can make bulk juices, and they last so well in the fridge. Now, if you want to get yourself a new machine and you're on the market for one and really want to get a good one, I suggest the J2, and you can save 10% by using my code, which is in the show notes. I also want to let you know that I have this beautiful farm in Northern Portugal that is open for the summer for retreats and events, and we would love to have you here. Once again, if you go into the show notes, I have put the link to my website with all the details. You're welcome to reach out, and hopefully we'll see you here. Okay, back to the episode. So Jeff is a master coach, author, entrepreneur, raw food expert, and self-confessed juice junkie. She loves the juices. And she's the founder, as I said, of Explore Raw, which is a beautiful company that started doing retreats and events, boot camps. She really did everything. She has the aim of supporting clients to seek their optimal wellness and health without judgment, without stress, without pressure. She does it so that she meets people where they're at, which is beautiful, because a lot of times we feel that we're not good enough or we're not ready to take the next step, and she makes it available for people to do that. Now, although her beautiful company Explore Raw is at the moment on pause, she is really opening up about her journey, and I really can't wait for you to listen to it. Okay, so without further ado, let's dive into this beautiful conversation. Welcome, Stephanie. Hi, Stephanie. Thank you for joining me on The Green Life. How are you?
I'm really great. How are you doing? It's a beautiful sunny day here in South Wales, the first one in a very, very long time. So I feel fantastic.
Oh, great. Here too, sunny and a little bit warm, which is good. we love our sun, and we live in two places where sometimes it's not very sunny, which is, we have similar weather in Northern Portugal and South Wales, which is really interesting.
Well, as you know, I moved back to South Wales, which is where I was brought up. I moved back just before the pandemic, and I was away for many years, and everyone used to tell me how much it rained in Wales, and I wouldn't believe them until I moved away. I realised it rains most of the time. So today, for it to be sunny is fantastic. I can't wait to get back out. So you get in the garden, do some jet washing, and get the garden ready for summer.
Nice. Yeah, we don't realize until we move somewhere, and nobody ever told us it would be so rainy up in Northern Portugal either. And then now we're like, yeah, this is how it used to be. I'm like, when we came and visit the first time to scout, it was November and it was 30 degrees and sunny. So, you know, anyway, yeah, nobody bothered to say this is not normal.
Yeah, it was a little freak weather.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm really happy that you're joining us today. You have a very interesting story. So if people don't know you, should we give them a little background about your journey into Explore Raw and how you left corporate and became your own boss and created a very good movement and so forth?
Okay, great. Wow. Yeah, this raw food movement. You know, it started for me thinking about my wellness. I mean, I don't run Explore Raw anymore. Everything is on pause. I'm calling it my big career break. But when I left corporate life, which was in, God, I was 39, and this was 2009. I left corporate life, so full-time corporate life. I was still doing a little bit of consulting afterwards. And I left, I was in really bad shape physically, mentally. I was exhausted. I was going through a difficult time in my personal life with a very tricky relationship. I was very just sluggish and down in every way imaginable. I was also suffering with polycystic ovaries and had been for all of my menstrual life, if that's an expression, and was just ready for a break. And I booked onto a juicing retreat thinking it's great for losing a little bit of weight, but you know, it's not going to really help anything else. I need to stick to the medication. And I was taking some heavy meds at the time, including tranexamic acid and metformin, which were doing absolutely nothing for me other than making me feel sicker. So my challenge to detox was maybe lose a few pounds. I mean, I was very overweight. I was clinically obese at the time. And a lot of that was from just being an inactive, lazy vegetarian, working in the corporate world, maxing out on expenses. So, you know, if we were going out for a meal, like, yeah, I'm sure you're going to be having starters, main course, and a side dish and a bottle of wine and, you know, all of that stuff. And it wasn't until I attended this retreat where I had this just many mind-blowing experiences. It was a crazy, beautiful, lovely week in nature with yoga and rest and juicing. And it kind of opened my eyes to many things that I was maybe drawn to intrinsically, or I mean, what might be a better word, just quite natural things that I was naturally thinking about, became good conversation at this retreat. So I was talking to someone who I thought was completely bonkers in the sauna. She was a lovely lady called Sandra, and she's still a good friend of mine now, and she was into raw food. And I was like, well, I can get juicing, but raw, I mean, why? And we had great conversation about raw food, about wellness, about juicing. It was great. And I lost something like 11 pounds on that 1 week. Huh. And to me, it was mind blowing because I'd been told by the medical profession that I couldn't lose weight because I might as well just eat all the chips because, you know, any diet wouldn't work because of how my body was processing certain foods with having polycystic ovaries and because of the medication. So for me, it was my first experience of losing some weight rapidly. So that was a wonderful mental boost. I'd had this week where I'd had a number of revelations. We were talking about food and spirituality, talking about everything that we take into our body, just not including, not only the food. And this week started a wonderful journey of exploration for me. I became raw for a year because I thought, well, hang on, if I can lose 11 pounds in a week, surely there might be something in this. And over a year, so when I was 39 to when I was 40, I was only focused on getting off the medication and balancing my menstrual cycle. So literally, because I don't really, when you're over 20 stone, I don't know what that is in pounds, but when you're over 20 stone, you don't tend to weigh yourself very often. So I really hadn't planned the journey that I was about to start. And so I didn't rigorously monitor myself with scales and measures and keep a log of things. But I worked it out from the last time that I'd measured, I'd weighed myself to the point that I was at. I remember my mum was saying, wow, God, those clothes are really bad. I thought, well, yeah, you know, I was always wearing all the loose yoga clothes, but things were really loose. And I weighed myself, where's those scales? Let's get them out. And we did. And I found that I thought, I've lost 9 stone. How do you not comprehend that? How are you not aware of that? Because my focus was so much into just looking and feeling amazing. I wasn't drinking, I wasn't eating all the rubbish anymore. I was doing lots of raw food and juicing. I was off the medication and I was starting to have a menstrual cycle again. So this became mind-blowing. Lots of people were asking me how I did it. And I was raising money for charity at the time for a lovely charity called Love 365. And I called my little 1 year of raw 365. To match it. I was raising money for children and young people to be rescued and rehabilitated from sex trafficking situations. So that was my mission. And this whole new world of feeling great in my skin, waking up every morning thinking, I've got energy and my knees aren't completely feeling like they're about to snap. This just, everything changed. Mm. And when I was 40, I had my first year of full cycles. I had 11 periods in 1 year. To me, that, again, it was mind-blowing. I'd never had that before. Periods were always a struggle. I had to plan or cancel holidays and events and days out, and days in work could be really quite difficult. But it was a complete 360. It was a real turnaround of wellness. I mean, my 40s definitely were my most vibrant and fulfilling days, and my best decade so far, I'm convinced. You know, it still builds and it still gets better, but this was the big turnaround for me. And I started doing some little workshops and talks for raising money for my charity, and it became explore raw. So I started teaching others and sharing what I had learned about wellness and myself. And I was trying to learn all the time and go on as many courses as I possibly could myself. And previously in corporate life, I used to run lots of retreats and leadership retreats. So the language of running a retreat was very natural for me. And I started running some boot camps purely because I know that you might maybe and maybe not remember this story. I know we've talked about it. As I was losing weight and in my early 40s, I've got to tone up. I'm losing all this weight. I've got to tone up and start to feel better about this body that I was able to move in a little more. And I booked onto a retreat that could handle someone who was a vegetarian. There was no real at that time, talking, was that 13, 14 years ago? Mm. There's no real variation in the menu. You know, you got the boot camp food that you got and that was it. So it was a meat eater's diet. So I really struggled with that. So I just had these quite small plates. I booked onto this boot camp to get fit, and lots of sort of celebs and sort of people go there to get instant results, and that's what I was looking for basically. When I was there, I was the oldest, the worst, the slowest, the fattest, the you name it. It was a place for quite young people, or at least that's the week that I was on. Everyone was very young, so I was struggling with lots of different things. I was just getting there. The long, slow clap when I came in from the runs because everyone else was on their next thing. They couldn't. I mean, I was just useless. It's not my thing. But something was really giving me a good kick up the bum, and so I thought, well, this can be plant based. This could easily be plant based. After this run, what I want is a really big green smoothie to kind of come down from what I thought I wasn't capable of. You know, I'm capable of this, but in a different way, using a different language. And I tried to find this place and I got laughed at and ridiculed quite a bit, which was the prompt for me to say, well, let me show you how it can be done. And so at the end of 2013, I set up my first raw juice camp, which was, as far as I know, from doing the research and trying to find something anywhere in the world for myself to attend. It was the first military style plant-based beach boot camp in the world. And we ran 40 events over the following years, and they just became mind-blowingly successful, which was wonderful. So I would teach some food preparation, some raw food insights and techniques, but the main thing was rest, rehabilitation, unlimited green smoothies with lots of lovely raw food, and fitness. I think I would draw a crowd quite like me. So always a mixture in the groups that we had, but definitely a slightly older crowd, I think, who could enjoy fitness, quite hardcore fitness sometimes, but in beautiful surroundings and at their own pace. And I guess an over 40s pace slightly, and amazing times. So with Explore Raw, things really unraveled for me, I mean, and blossomed and bloomed. So I was running my retreats. I had a cookery school in London. I think on the language of food, that's when you and I met, and yeah, we're talking about raw food and lifestyle coaching, some similar things that we do. And I wrote a book which was very successful. I launched a spiralizer that was very successful, and we started running more gentle retreats in a nature reserve. So right up until the pandemic, that was my life, 100%. Post-pandemic, things are a little different, because how do you try and decipher all that's happened in the last of 2.5, 3 years? Mind-blowing. Another conversation. I know you and I talk about this a lot. But life completely changed for many people, and for me included, yeah.
Yeah, well, let me just go back to your story. When did you leave corporate to dive fully into Explore Raw?
I would say about a year after leaving, a year, 18 months after leaving corporate life full time. It wasn't long at all. I set up my leadership development consultancy. My name's Stephanie Lamerton now, because I married during this last phase of, what do I call it? Not AD and BC, but yeah, BC and AC. Before coronavirus and after coronavirus. So I got married AC. So I'm Stephanie Lamerton now, and I was Jeff's. So I had Stephanie Jeff's leadership development consultancy that was, again, very successful, thankfully, helped me bank some cash before I had to start a very brave new business with Explorer. But yeah, I don't think that lasted more than 18 months. And also one thing to say is that being, and even then, you know, middle-aged, over 40, starting to go grey, out of shape, still had weight to lose, and my weight would still kind of go up and down depending on how I was looking after myself. I found more difficult than setting up a taxi rank in a new road in an established city. You know, it was hard work to, I think, find my space, or at least for me to feel comfortable in the space that was there for me. Perhaps that was a little bit more, but I found it wasn't an overnight thing. I know lots of people think, oh, you know, put out a recipe for a green smoothie, I went insta famous and here's my mega business. It's graft finding your feet in a new space, and particularly online. And I don't think it's got any easier. I think it's much, much harder even now. Yeah.
It's definitely harder, because one thing is, of course, it's challenging when you're starting something new, which you experienced, but you also were a groundbreaker in it. You know, like, there were not many people that were doing this. There were not many people that were talking about raw in a mainstream way. Now it's much more mainstream.
Yes.
So it's harder because people are like, this is new. They don't know it. You have to get the people that are open-minded and want to try something new, or desperate that they've tried everything else and like, I've got nothing to lose, let me try this out. It wasn't a conversation that was had, you know, to be had very easily. Now it's very overcrowded, and the algorithm doesn't help, because now the algorithm favors, you know, these accounts that they call influencers. Most of them really don't know what they're doing. They don't necessarily give good advice, but they're popular, they look amazing. And we've gone into this very superficial way of looking at people's bodies, forgetting that we all different shapes genetically. You know, we have different shapes, and I guess the the composition of our body is very different, right? Like, somebody would put more weight or fat on the hips, other people on the belly. And so not everybody's going to have the same composition, but an optimal diet that is made for us human, which is mostly actually eating living foods and lots of fruit, would then give you the best body that you can have with your composition and with your shape. But now everybody's looking at these sticks, and everybody wants to look like a stick, and we're not going to all look like a stick. It's just not going to happen.
Well, who said it to me first? It was a doctor's appointment about something. It would may have been about my polycystic ovaries, but I went to a doctor and I was at my, I call it my fighting weight. At my fighting weight, it was 13 and a half stone. So for me, I thought, no, I don't want to go any lower than that, because I don't want to lose my boobs. I love my curves. This is great. I feel comfortable. Any less than this, and I feel too thin for me. I don't know if there is a too thin. But I remember a doctor saying, no, keep going with the weight loss. You can get down to 10 stone. You can be a size 10. I just thought, I'd be on a drip if I was 10 stone. You know, I'm 5'10". I have size 8 feet. I'm a tall, broad, large person. And to me, I thought, wow, that, you know, the numbers here are so wrong, and the level of judgment and what people think that, you know, you should be. I remember it was one of my very first retreats, and the lady turned on. I'd be taking my glasses off and on. I'm afraid I'm at that age where I'm struggling to find my eye distance. I remember I opened the door to the villa, and I'd always imagined this, you know, like people dressed in white and all floaty and inviting people to this beautiful space, and which we did all the time, obviously, but so many times we weren't ready because we would fly in the same day as the clients. We only got keys to the villa a few hours before. So it was always this quite frantic thing, this quite frantic situation as people were arriving off their flights coming in. And this one lady arrived at the front door, and if you've ever been overweight or been judged for whatever about yourself, when you feel those judging eyes, you know. And I had the full body scan. And
she said,
you know, are you Stephanie? Can I see Stephanie? Are you Stephanie Jeffs? Say, hey, you know, that's me. Come on in. And instantly I thought, God, what, you know, I've done it. I've detoxed. I've lost all this weight. My body's in balance. I feel amazing. I'm at the lowest adult weight I've ever been, you know, and I looked and felt fab and was still receiving judgment. So I wonder what the lessons are in there. Just, yeah, push the judges back, because you're not going to be perfect enough for everybody in the world who thinks you should be something or someone else. But
no.
one of the few moments that I really sort of took that with me, I thought, you know what, for some people, you'll never be good enough. And these are they would tend to be the people at my retreats who, what's the word, would be less responsive perhaps to new info, wants to do the fitness and drop the weight quickly. But when we were teaching and talking and in the kitchen making things together, perhaps we're less interested in some of the key take homes that they can take home themselves, looking for those instant wins maybe.
Yeah, that's the problem. Yeah. And yeah, people have to really, well, one, drop the judgment, but you know, that reflects a lot on that person and as many people, how they look at themselves. Like this constant, I have to be perfect, I have to be super lean, I have to look in a certain way. It's exhausting. Like I, from experience, I can tell you it's exhausting, you know, like anorexia was for me, it really came, I mean, there were a lot of issues that I wasn't aware at the time, but one of the things was that I was brought up being told I was too big. I was never big. I was just very athletic. Like, you know, I did sports, I was athletic. I was bigger than my sister. I wasn't skinny, but
yeah.
I was never actually overweight as a child. I was very athletic. And yet, you know, because my mother had eating disorders, she always projected her standards on me, so I was never thin enough. So obviously when I became anorexic, that was like, for me, I didn't feel well. Like I have gaps in memory, I didn't have my period, I was exhausted, but I was happy that I was lean. Like for the first time in my life, I was skinny. I wasn't lean, I was skinny. And and then I, you know, when I got out of it, I didn't have a good relationship with food. And it's consuming to look at your body. And I still do suffer from body dysmorphia. Like I know that I need to catch myself and be like, I do meditation about, no, you are good. You're in a good place. You look good. Don't worry. You're eating the right foods. You're taking care of yourself. You're healthy. Because my body, my mind can go really in places. You know, I can see my body in the mirror in a very different way, like distorted, and I catch myself now. So it's exhausting to be so judgmental towards yourself. And, you know, that person probably had that. And then you look at people, well, I don't do it anymore, but I used to look at people and really be like, oh, these people that are thin have it all together. And now, and the people that are like overweight are like, oh, they're failing like me. And it's not the case. And it's really such a distorted way that our mind has been, you know, manipulated to work. And this is really down to, of course, the media forever. You know, you see people on TV that we just worship this beauty image of like lean and tall. Hey, we're not all 6 feet, you know, we're not all size zero. Like, it's crazy. It's just not a good place to be. And most of these people
don't
even.
It's a massive topic. I totally agree.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And again, something that I learned, I mean, probably like you, I'll always have issues, not with my body, but issues on what other people think my body should be like.
Mm.
Even now, I mean, I'm 53 this year, and even now I'll get, because I've put some weight back on since lockdown. I've not been, again, we'll touch on this perhaps a bit more later. We've talked about this, you know, as friends already, how so many people have, lost the way, that's the wrong expression. So many people have had to pause things that they're passionate about. For whatever reason that is, it's how it's been. And people who are coming out of this strange lockdown era, this COVID era, whatever you want to call it, so psychologically damaged, they think badly enough about themselves. They don't need to be told. And even I've had someone quite recently say, oh, how much do you weigh now? I'm like, wow, is this information for you? It's okay, you know, I'm happily living my life. Yeah, massive, massive topic. One of the things that doing my retreats and boot camps did teach me, because I can remember my boot camp, the language of boot camp was perhaps more so about weight loss than our retreats, but they were both wellness spaces where at boot camp, if you needed to lose 10 pounds in a week, we could do our best to help you get that off. I mean, obviously not some kind of sustainable thing. And even at our retreats, when it was we used to just pretty much eat all day. So we're making food, raw, beautiful raw food all day. People would tend to leave with a similar kind of weight loss. So, well, that was interesting. So it wasn't the volume, it was the shift in the diet, and everyone ate until they were satisfied and so on. But the learning for me was I would see gods and goddesses turn up time and time again at my retreats. And I'd be... But you're so gorgeous, and you know what? Do you need this? This was, you know, what are you? And it was, and again, I was getting stuck in that same old thing that I was trying to avoid just by judging on what you're seeing. These people came for a beautiful detox and a rest. And I would often look at them in their beautiful leggings, you know, whilst we were doing meditation or yoga, thinking, you've so got your life together. Is this just a little break for you? You're not as broken and fat as even as me, you know. And but the lesson was, really, everyone has something that they're massively worried about, that they panic about, that they've had it drilled into them maybe over the years and by loved ones, that, you know, you need to sort yourself out, something needs fixing. And the lesson all the time for me was, well, all of us, we are A-okay just as we are.
Yeah. Yeah. And healing is for everyone. Everybody is on a very disturbed planet. Just being here, we all need healing and dealing with this life. And as you mentioned, the three years that we just went through, that definitely didn't help the situation, because people had to put their life on pause. There was a lot of fear. There was a lot of irrational behavior.
Yeah.
There was a lot of ignorance, sadly, even by the medical community, which is not surprising, because as you made testament of at the beginning, they were telling you could not lose weight, you cannot recover from PCOS.
Yeah.
And that's not the case. And it's never been the case. And it's just, this is one thing that comes up on the podcast a lot in the conversations with every expert, including doctors, that they have educated themselves about nutrition and lifestyle, is that when you are taught in a system that is just about prescribing medications and looking at symptoms and how to deal with symptoms, there is no healing. Because they don't know what wellness means. They haven't been taught. And they have spent a lot of hours and a lot of money to do that course. So it's not even their fault that they don't know. But there is a part of it that it's human ego. I've spent so much money, so many hours, so many sacrifices I've made to become a doctor. There is no way that I don't know what I'm talking about. Instead of being humble and think, okay, I've just been given one side of it. Let me look at what's broader, what's more, what is there that I haven't been taught and I can teach myself now. And the doctors that do, they become amazing physicians and they really do heal people. The ones that don't stay stuck in the system, prescribing medication and not reading studies, not studying, because they think that if their primary at the hospital tells them this is how it's going to be, this is the rule that the hospital has and this is what we're going to apply, that's what they do without questioning, then, you know, that's exactly what happened during the last 3 years.
And absolutely. And you're making me giggle slightly, not because it's funny, because how many times do we have to hear this same thing? And I'll give you a personal story. Even recently, I've relocated, so I'm back in South Wales. I've signed up with a new doctor. Not that I had a very personal relationship with my GP in the UK anyway, because I hardly ever... I'm not a regular visitor, but I've been getting lots of pain in my foot and I have a slight bone growth in my foot, which is stopping me from enjoying some really long walks. It can be really painful. And within the first few sentences of me trying to explain what was wrong, my new GP said, well, from how you've presented yourself to me today, I do believe I'd be quite happy to put you on antidepressants. I said, well, the pain, I don't understand, the pain is in my foot, because it could have been part of menopause, and obviously what comes with that is the depression and the stress. I said, I don't really think I need that, but some painkillers, which I never take, I don't take, if I have a headache, I go in somewhere cool and dark. I really am not a fan, because this type of medication and pill popping just has never worked for me, particularly in my elder years, I say that this just says the 40 plus, so the new lifestyle and the new revelations and new way of looking after myself. There's just no way I would be taking paracetamol even for a headache. But anyway, I've succumbed. I've been taking a painkiller for my foot. As I find out that after an X-ray, I may have been walking around on a fractured foot for some time. So that's something quite different to do. No green smoothie is going to get me through that. But the point is, like you say, as soon as I'm in there, you know, feeling a bit down with my pain, let's get you on the antidepressants. No, I'm absolutely fine. I just need some sunshine and, you know, fix it, fix this pain for me. That's what I need. But too easily done, way too easily done. No one asked about, if you're thinking about my wellness, no one asked about my lifestyle, how I'm feeling mentally, what I'm, you know, what I'm doing, what's happening in my life, what I'm eating. It's just not discussed at all. You know all of this. So it's just not discussed. Straight to the prescription.
Yeah, exactly. Point in case what we were talking about. And I feel that, you know, actually, let's talk about your experience through the pandemic, because I know you felt it deeply at a mental level. Obviously, you relocated to South Wales 3 years ago, just before COVID happened. And then you kind of changed your life. You had to pause a lot of things. So now you are Explore Raw is on pause. And you dove into your family life, you were trying to sell your flat in London to buy a new property in Wales, which finally happened, but it took a bit longer than you expected. And also, you know, there were a lot of things happening, like an adjustment to your life, and then being thrown into these lockdowns. How did you cope? And also, how did that affect your lifestyle in the sense of your routine with your food and, you know, with the good things that you always know how to do for yourself? Did that change? I'd like to know how that really impacted your habits.
It was complete chaos. Now, I mean, I'm a very spontaneous, creative person by nature, but one of the things that the corporate world did give me was the skill of planning, project management, and organizing. So I'm someone who, I know what I'm doing pretty much most weekends or most weeks, 6 to 12 months ahead, easily 6 to 12 months ahead. So I was planning boot camps, workshops, retreats, and so on. So I had to get flights in. Are you looking at this 6 to 12 month calendar? And my last retreat was October 2019. And that was it's become the last until I run another one. And I may not, who knows? Can't even believe I'm saying it. And at that retreat, it was our 40th birthday. And I had what I believe was a universal download. And I never received that voice before. It was very spiritual for me, and something or someone, a voice told me, this is the last time you're going to do this. And I was like, literally, I was like, don't be ridiculous, this is what I do. And I knew that I was taking a pause, so I wouldn't have been doing my workshops in London in my cookery school for the winter. So I had to start planning for a wedding. As you know, I was married. I couldn't even tell you the date because of COVID, because it was rescheduled 3 times. But we did a hand fasting to finalise and seal the deal last year. So lots to plan and organise. And I thought, we'll move, we'll get married. This is a 6 months break. Fantastic. Having myself a mini career break. And we never went back to things. I sold the house finally, which was a struggle at that time because of Brexit, was affecting the market. So my house that normally would, in the area it's in, it would sell within days. It was taking weeks and then months. It'd been kind of on the market for a year. So you think, how much more stress can we get? Little did we know what was coming, you know, March 2020. And I came, my last trip abroad, I actually came to see you in Portugal. and I was looking for some new venues for running my retreats in that sort of summer. So work was still on my mind. Now, along came this wonderful pandemic era, which challenged all of us. And if ever anyone has said to themselves, because I have, stop the world, I want to get off, can we just press pause on everything? Can everything stop so I can catch up and have the rest? Well, boy, we all had that. And I don't think many people did rest. So we were just... Well, Andrew was moving into a rental. We just sold the house. I was bringing a lot of my furniture down to Wales. And we thought, well, you know, we've got all the time in the world. We had a van. We thought we'd go back and forth, this 200-mile journey back and forth with stuff until the right things were in storage and the right thing was in the kind of temporary rental. And it just didn't happen. On our first trip, it was locked down. So I suddenly find myself in Wales with no clothes. All I had really was a little bag of things that were with me. I'd left everything in London because I feel so silly at the time. You know, you kind of assume that with these barriers, you are not allowed to travel. Well, of course, well, let's take this very seriously. What is going on here? Of course, I was sticking to those logistical rules. It was a heat wave, which was sort of an early March heat wave, which is, I wouldn't even say very rare. Very rare. Has it even ever happened in the UK before? Hashtag weather management. I'm not so sure. So we're in the middle of this amazing heat wave, enjoying the sunshine with no furniture, no Wi-Fi, our bikes and a couple of bits. We had no washing machine, no fridge, nothing. So the state of panic of just having nothing and feeling so, is bereft the right word? So we felt, if you like, so it was a snapshot. When lockdowns came, whatever situation you were in, you were locked into that situation for at least 5-6 months because nobody was moving around at that time at all. And you may recall, because lots of us still do, and why the world isn't up in arms, or even my local community isn't up in arms, I don't know, that people were getting arrested or bullied or sent home for having a coffee on the beach or sitting quietly.
Mm-hmm.
And so being outside, I mean, these are the massive conversations, but it was very stressful. So because we had no Wi-Fi, we had no Zoom, so even less logging on today, how clumsy was I about that? It's a natural skill for everyone. We had nothing. We used to do lots of little discos. We used to play music from my phone. We had little discos at home. It's self-entertainment. So on reflection, it was absolutely wonderful. So we had nothing to stress about. We didn't have lots of objects to clean. It was the first time the three of us had lived together, myself, my husband and my stepson. So many things were, on reflection, it didn't feel great at the time, absolutely wonderful. Although we were in a tiny space, we had each other. So for our relationships, it was amazing. Our stress levels, mind you, were on another scale because I couldn't have access, because I couldn't do it online with a 4G signal. I couldn't do any of my banking. I couldn't get online. For the everyday stuff, the little things that we take for granted, a quick online order, a quick Zoom. We tried joining into some Zoom get-togethers with friends. It just wouldn't work. We didn't have a really good signal. So I suppose a lot of stress eating came to play. It was a very long time until I had my blenders and my juicers with me. And the old me would have said, well, great, we don't have the juices. We'll just chop it up. It's all salads and fruit salads, you know, sort of every day. But it didn't become that. There was so much anxiety and stress. And then as our understanding of what really was happening in the world became deeper, because I would be up at night watering my plants. I was growing things. I grew a 4-foot basil plant called Sid. He was amazing. So little projects like that would keep me going. But I'd be up late at night listening to YouTube, watching YouTube videos and catching up with the news through social media. And the more and more I was becoming aware of what was happening in the world, my anxiety was off the scale. It seemed to us that, well, you know, the world was going to explode or implode. So I can speak for myself, and I think my husband very much the same. We became very introverted. We started to really looking inwards to ourselves for stress management, which was awful. In the UK, you couldn't go out. You had your hour walk. And if you were seen out too much, people would be making those calls. It was a horrible, horrible time. So diet-wise, I wasn't looking after myself. I think it was something that I had to give. I had very little control over what, or maybe just, I haven't really analysed it. Very little control of what was going in my mouth, because I had much less control of what foods we could get into the house or get onto my plate. And with being in a new area, and you had your little, if you were queuing up to get some of the big supermarkets, it could take hours and you were limited in what you could purchase. Interestingly, what I thought was horrendous, perhaps a giggle for some, was that throughout lockdown, we could only buy essential items. So clothes weren't considered essential items. And I literally had 2 t-shirts, a couple of pairs of pants and not for it. So it was a good job. It was a heat wave because I had very little to wear. I couldn't buy anything. So very stressful. It felt very isolating. All my house sale fell through in London. All my stuff was up there. I had a leak in the house. Things, it was just way too much. Our wedding that we'd planned for May obviously was cancelled. We thought we'd have it the year after it was cancelled. And we just literally had everything finalized. Well, fine. We had a fantastic wedding and party this last May. So yeah, life was very, very, very out of control. And my morning water and spirulina waters, my juices and lots of cleansing that I would do every morning before I'd eat a proper meal at two, just kind of went out the window. Andrew was an early morning toast kind of guy, so I became an early morning toast kind of girl. Toast is one of my favorite foods anyway. So along back into my diet came, you know, the big mugs of black coffee, getting me through. Lovely chunky sourdough toast, because I managed to master making my own sourdough, so I thought I was champion of the world in the kitchen again. Lovely great big buttery sourdoughs and big mugs of coffee in the morning. That's what was getting me through, and that's what my diet became.
Yeah, I think a lot of people can relate to this. I personally had, for me, the pandemic was what you described, like really everything paused, and I actually had the time to catch up without the pressure. For me was that, but I had hit rock bottom by that time. So yeah. I needed it, because there was just no way I could go any lower. I'm like, oh, you know what? Yeah. I'm good. But and to be honest with you, one of the things that really frustrated me about what was happening is that nobody was talking about wellness at all. Like, you know, it was all about fear, being separated, lockdowns, and nobody was talking about, by nobody, I mean the institutions that were going to the majority of people, talking about our lifestyle, our diet. And so people were just left with stress, panic, fear, and coping mechanism, which we know food is one of them.
Yeah.
And this brings up a lot of things for people where they don't realize how they eat emotionally, and then they do.
Yeah.
And you know, for me, like when I started working on Zoom, for me, it was good for me, myself personally, and for my clients, because it was a way that we could really, you know, move together and discuss health. And that was a topic that was very touchy, though, because of course they were listening to the news and they were following that, you know, kind of narrative instead of questioning things. And so I had to kind of navigate that, and probably I made the mistake of being too vocal about what didn't make sense to me. So I was called names and canceled, things that happen, which to be honest, in retrospect, probably it's not a bad thing, because then I look at the behavior, like for me, you know, that time of really pausing and looking after myself was just a kickstart into what I'm doing now as well. But for a lot of people, it was like, it's so nice that we can actually, you know, it's a lesson that we're getting, that we're saying, the people that were in my class, especially, that we are rushing too much and we need to make time for our wellness. And lo and behold, when everything's opened up again, they are frantic, they are stressed, they're not well, they're not looking after their wellness, they're back at square one. And so it just really begs to the question, how much are we really learning from our experiences? And the ones that did, I think, are thriving now. At least they're recognizing what was happening. And if anything happened again, they would navigate it much better than the ones that just threw themselves back in society thinking, well, it's over now. And not really planning for the fact that actually these kind of shifts really do impact our mental health, you know, whatever we are.
Yeah, absolutely. From what my experience of the world right now, I struggle to understand why everyone, whether they've had certain needs or not, why everyone isn't pulling together as a community, say, and just talking, first of all, but acknowledging that we're all just ranging from a little bit to massively, a little bit more screwed up than we were before we started, you know, before the whole of COVID thing was a thing. And to me, it's mind-blowing. I mean, look at all the horrific things that we all saw. Again, the fear that was being thrown out on all of these channels. But it's perhaps relating to how we deal with trauma from our childhood and other stages in our life. No, are we just shifting it to the back so that we can move on? I don't know. But there is so much that's been unspoken and unsaid. There's so much healing, because we've pulled all the, I don't know, all these stories are out and they've been suppressed. I don't know how long as a society or as a human race or as individuals we can keep suppressing all of the things that are happening in the world. So many, and you perhaps have seen this as well, are just I'm glad it's all over and carrying on back into that old groove.
Yeah.
Well, I can't understand how for many things haven't substantially changed. And maybe that's because my life has substantially changed, not directly related to COVID. You know, I'm not a single woman in the morning who can lie in until 10 if my energy's not right, do my yoga, have my juice, wipe down the surface of the kitchen and my house still looks lovely all day. You know, I have a very active 12-year-old stepson. You know, he's been a massive part of my life and running around after him a lot and to his needs and actually trying to get him into smoothies and juicing. He can make all his own juices and things now, which is a lovely triumph for he's a sausage and chips kind of boy. And I'm a busy wife and mum in a totally new groove. And what I've had to try to do is make space, and it sounds like the biggest deal in the world, make space for my wellness, where I'm sort of carving out my new kind of groove in life with me in it. That's something that that's the stage that I'm working at now. And I've started, we're lucky enough, we've got a lot of space at home. We've got a sauna at home, so we have a sauna every other morning. We'll be putting our pool up, thankfully, now that the sun is coming out, so we can do some splashing around and focus on some more of kind of us time and some rest, some deep rest. And also the smoothies more regularly are coming back into the diet, which is great. And I need to do that because I have some new health challenges. So whereas prior to my 40s, I was suffering with polycystic ovaries. And I do remember saying to myself, oh Lord, please, you know, if you're listening, give me a great menopause. And thankfully I have. I think from all the years that I suffered with my flow and with my cycle, really bad. Really, just this call. Sometimes things were pretty medieval and very, very painful and very irregular. My menopause was quite breezy. I can't separate general menopause, depression and physical changes. I can't separate any of that from the COVID era. It's all mixed up with the stress and putting on weight of that. Could the menopause have been playing a role in there? Possibly, but I don't feel massively scarred or in some kind of menopause bad place. But throughout the pandemic, my sister was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she's been treated for the medical profession, who've given her the all clear, and now she's waiting for a double mastectomy so that she minimizes her chances of recurrence. My mum passed away with breast cancer related illness, and my grandmother also. So I was tested for what they call the BRCA gene. Mm. And I can even remember waiting for my test results. No, my sister's 5'2". She takes after my mum. I'm 5'10". Take after my dad. No, this is from my mum. We're just talking myself that this isn't going to happen to me. And my blood tests came back as positive. And my tests have indicated that I have an over my lifetime 85 to 95% chance of developing aggressive breast cancer. So various, a new health, a massive and a new health challenge. So this is something that I can't green smoothie my way out of, but this is something where if I'm really plugging back in and making space again so hugely as I did before, and that gave me huge a huge change in my lifestyle, my wellness, myself, who I am physically, mentally and spiritually. I'm ready to plug back in because now this is, if you like, my new burning platform. So I don't have cancer. What I have is a propensity to develop cancer that my body would be unable to deal with. Does it happen? So what's on the cards for me down the medical route is a preventative double mastectomy with reconstruction. And again, that's no green smoothie is going to get me out of that situation or that challenge, but getting to that place where I decide that these operations are right for me, I can do that in a more healthful and mindful way. Because at the moment, for the last 3 years, my head is all over the place. Now things are just starting to settle. because we've moved, we're married now, all the stuff, life stuff is really starting to settle down. So my new challenge is around being very focused about managing my hormones, my wellness, and getting to a place where, because I don't think I'm fully committed to these operations yet, there's a lot more I need to research and read. But with talking to my sister, who is very different to me in terms of how we think about nutrition, food, the NHS, and how it serves us, my sister's voice was, when I was exploring with her, you know, do I need them? Should I just wait for something? You know, should I just keep the mammograms going? Is this going to really, I could be that 15% that this is never going to happen to. And her guiding words, which really landed quite harshly with me, her guiding words were, she said, I know it sounds weird, thinking, well, should I cut off my arm in case I break it? This is a way different. You do not want chemo because you would rather be dying. It is horrendous. And talked me through her experience in a way that she'd not shared before. So I found that really, that left a huge impression on me. So some big things to think about. And not a lovely thing to happen to anyone, but a doorway to get me back onto the route to being on top of my wellness. Well, I don't feel on top of my wellness now. Since lockdown, like many people say, mentally, I'm not in as good a place as I was when I went in, but I know where I'm heading with that. And I certainly don't need antidepressants from a GP for going in with a bad foot. And I've put weight on. Someone's trying to call me again. There we go. I've put weight on, and as we were talking about earlier, it's not the only indicator. Or getting healthy isn't just about losing the pounds. I think for me, unless that is done with intent and focusing on overall wellness, that's where it needs to be. For, I'm not sure, I was sure where I was going with that sentence, but the first time I did it, as you remember, I was telling you that I was focusing on just getting off the medication. Mm-hmm. And for me now, my focus, which the weight loss will be part of it, so I'm happy with about that. The focus for me is to enter into making these big decisions with the clearest mind and the cleanest body that I can get at my age now.
Mm.
If that makes sense. So many things. Again, it's the mind, body, spirit,
journey.
Approach, journey. Yeah, it's very, very holistic. But one thing I never ever stopped, to be honest, I never stopped. I haven't drunk tap water for years and don't plan to either. Always have my beautifully filtered water. And I've never stopped with doing gentle yoga. I mean, stretching. I went to a yoga class the other day and literally I thought, this is embarrassing. I can't do the jump forwards with my feet, can't lift my hips anymore. But then, exactly, gentle stretching I've been doing. So the minimum, water and stretching. How ridiculous that's, I think, is whatever survival mode I'm in now, also whatever mode I am in now, I think it's just hanging on to something has got me through. But in any other way, other survival mode was, it's the buttery toast and coffee every morning. It's just been beautiful. Hasn't helped my waistline, but mentally it's helped me feel great. Beautiful breakfast with my family, wonderful.
Yeah, to be honest, thank you for sharing that was really good. I think I'm gonna just mention a couple of things that I think a lot of people that may be in the same situation as you, where they have to, maybe they found out they have the BRCA gene and they have to think about the next steps. I think one of the most important things is to understand that because now we understand epigenetic, there is definitely genetic components that make us more susceptible to certain things. And in your case, of course, you have a higher chance of getting breast cancer or ovarian cancer in some cases with this gene, but it's not a sentence. And I think it's really important to understand, because the medical field makes it sound that it is and it's not, because the point is this. We all have cancerous cells in our body, and then our immune system deals with them so that we don't get tumors. And the other thing is also that tumors thrive in an acidic environment. So most people are in a state of acidosis and don't even know it because of the environment and the food that we're having. And because of that, cancer can indeed grow. And the other thing is taking out a part of your body that doesn't actually stop cancer from coming, because your breast might be where maybe because of your genetic, affiliation with your parents, your mom and your sister, that's where it might manifest first. But cancer can come anywhere because, again, it's about acidosis. You know, doctor, I interviewed Dr. Moores, Robert Moores, who is amazing. He's a naturopath who actually understands the lymphatic system. And I haven't met many, many even naturopaths that understand it the way that he does. And I always question certain things. He really confirmed them for me. And I found evidence of what I was looking for. And then when people talk about metastasis of a cancer cell, it's so idiotic the way that is shared, because it makes it sound like cancer cells travel between one part of the body to another. And that's not the case. The point is your body's wholly acidic, and then the cells that are going to mutate into cancer cells can do it anywhere into the body. So metastasis actually doesn't mean that they're traveling from one place where you have a tumor already to another part of your body. It just means that actually your whole body tissues are acidic, and therefore these cells can thrive anywhere, and they will probably grow in different parts because your immune system is not picking up any of them. So there is such a conversation to be had about this. And I also interviewed Dr. Véronique Dessaunier, who actually beat cancer twice, and she did it holistically, but she supports women that even want to go through things like they want to adopt options like chemo, for example. And so those are resources that I think when anybody finds out they are sick, remember, to get sick, it takes years. It doesn't happen overnight. Mm-hmm. And so you have time to make choices, to make decisions, which is not given by the medical professionals oftentimes, where they're just pushing you to make a choice very quickly, otherwise you might die tomorrow, or they give you a certain time to live, which is so wrong because nobody could really predict that. It's just out of your hands. You're a human. You don't know. It's not really right. But of course, there are some legal reasons why they do it, which is not fair. But, you know, but they scare people.
One thing I certainly feel is that although I don't have to face the choice at the moment, and hopefully never, of do I need or when am I having my chemo, I definitely have a holistic mindset when it comes to managing what would you call that severe health issues, let's say. Because there's and bearing in mind I avoided having a hysterectomy in my 30s because I didn't fancy going down that route. I thought, well, you know, you never know, I might still need these parts of my body for something. I don't have natural children, and had I carried on taking the drugs, if you like, would it have led me to a surgical diagnosis? I don't know. But one thing I can say is that going through the NHS process of being diagnosed, talking to your genetic consultants, and it's a fast track gravy train to get you to have parts of your body cut off. And it's mind-blowing having to face it. Well, it is an option. Shall I get monitored? But you're still in that medical system. You know, there are still issues, as you know, with, you know, regular mammograms or even a mammogram. There's very little. Well, there isn't any capacity when you're in these meetings. You have certain meetings. I couldn't even tell you what each one is for, because it just, you get a letter to come for your next trip. There you go. Everything's fallen off. Sorry about that, lovely. When you get your letter for your next stage meeting, let me prop this back up. There's no capacity for real dialogue. There's no capacity for natural dialogue. And one of the things that I've been pushed to consider at every meeting is, when am I having my implants? You know, what are you talking about? I'm not going to have any implants. Is that in my body? There we go. Are we back on? There we go. Sorry, it was me knocking everything over. It's fast track, and at every meeting, it's a new doctor looking through my nose. So implants. Well, it's never been. Let's forget it. It's not a conversation. If anything happens, it'll either be non-surgical or non-surgical self-surgery, not self-surgery, what's that, reconstruction from my own tissue, from my own flesh. But yeah, the process is I find very fast. There's no discussion outside of any medical or surgical boxes. And I do believe, and for me it's the same with the polycystic ovaries, I didn't have any answers. I'm not medically trained or trained to the ins and outs of the body to that level, but I just knew that cleaning the slate, cleaning up my lifestyle was, God, that just makes total sense. It has to have an impact. And it did for me massively. So I'm not saying that I won't be able to turn around any potential future diagnosis, but I can certainly do my best to kind of clean the swamp again. I mean, I'm not a walking health hazard to myself. I'm not, again, massively broken that I need fixing. But again, getting back into the rhythms of what serves me and myself, my body, the best way that I know. And also, I wonder if, and you know so much more about this than me, you do, you're great with your research and your learning, is that what is different? What can be different? How can my approach be different now that I'm in my 50s? Because when I started wellness, I was the last year of my 30s, which seems like decades and decades ago, but also a very short space of time as well. I remember asking my sister, I said, "Boy, I wonder what I would have done. I wonder where I would be. I wonder how much I would be earning. Would I have private medical care still?" You know, so your brain goes back to these trappings of corporate life. I wonder what I'd be doing now had I not left. Straight away, without hesitation, well, you'd be dead.
Mm-hmm.
All right, okay then. So being overweight and fed up version of me is actually way better than being dead. So I'm happy with that, and also happy that I completely turned my health around through an era that could have been horrendous for me. But without hesitation, so the amount that you were drinking, eating, you were nonstop on flights, traveling for work, the hours you were working, the stress that comes with a job like that, no, we really couldn't see you lasting much longer. So to hear that, you're like, yeah, okay, slight, if I can, slight fluctuations in my weight that's generally on a downward trajectory, yeah, I can handle that as opposed to dead. You know?
Yeah, totally. I think, as you said, you know, it's so funny. Like, first of all, when I left banking, I also just knew that I didn't belong there and that I would get sick if I stayed there. I mean, the last 6 months of my time there, I really didn't care if I was doing well or not. And my job, because I was so fed up with the whole environment and the negativity and the pressure and the politics. I mean, it was so toxic. And the things that matter in life are never highlighted. And then, of course, you start learning things outside. You know, you start learning truth about the world and
how it works.
You can't possibly be in the matrix when you know there is a matrix. It's really... Yeah. I mean, I know this is, that can sound so conspiratorial to some people. I get it, but it's not. It's just like this revelation that you get through really inner journeying. And you know, I got this revelation also from the yoga community. Like, what a bullshit place sometimes it can be.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You know, so I call it as I see it as I go through it, because I just realized that I never fit any mold or any environment 100%. And I always put that on me as I there was something wrong with me up to now. But then I realized, actually, you know what? If you're a truth seeker, the truth is you're not going to fit in, because truth is not linear. It's not straightforward. There are so many variables in this life, because the lies had to be quite elaborated to stand for such a long time. So I have to truly always navigate that. But I also know that by listening to what I was feeling, that was feeling truth, that I had to leave, was the best choice I've ever made. Now, that was when my health started. I mean, I started getting healthier before I left banking. And when I turned vegan, it was just, you know, the best thing ever, because I was whole food plant-based without even knowing that word at the time. But going vegan, going whole food plant-based is such a revelation, such a good thing. It did amazing things for my body, for my health, for my mental health. And then I got myself back, just, you know, before the pandemic, I got myself in a very dark place with my health. And a lot of stuff came up. And that's the dark night of the soul, where you just, like, as I said, rock bottom, and you have to deal with it. And it doesn't matter when it happens for people. It will happen at some point. For a lot of people, it happens just before menopause. I threw myself into early perimenopause, which I reversed, thankfully. But because of that, dark night of the soul, right there, you had to deal with it. And sure, it was shit at the time, but it was such a good thing to go through, because I had to do it. I had to know that I had to go deeper in healing, literally at cellular level, at ancestral level. I had to go down my family ancestry and be like, ooh, you know, the stuff here that is coming up. There are so many things that I could have ended up with cancer. I could have ended up with a lot of things. I am predisposed to getting, to managing my glucose very poorly, right? So diabetes is something that I could easily get. And although my family, my immediate family only got diabetes like in the later years because of lifestyle and diet and nutrition, because they ate really poorly, there is that genetic component, because, you know, of the way that we were raised and the habits, and your body adapts to certain things. And then I'm sure genetically stress can cause things like poor management of your metabolism, because you, when you have more cortisol in your body than you need, your sugar will go up. So all these things people don't think about if we are thinking just about disease and symptoms. But when you're actually thinking about holistically, there are so many elements. So leaving that environment was a good thing. And then having to crash and burn with my health and then setting up myself again was a good thing. And, you know, it's the same thing parallel to you. Like, you know, you did that journey the first time and now you have to do it again with the lessons learned in a different phase. Now that your hormones are actually quite settled, because now you're in menopause and you're done with all these up and down, it's a good thing actually to look after yourself now again and adjust it to what your needs are and understand and learn about what is that your body's needing right now in this phase of your life. And, you know, even though we don't have our period anymore when we get into menopause, we still have hormones fluctuations. We still maybe very little progesterone being produced, but you still have it happening. So how do you support these things happening? How do you support your pituitary gland? How do you support your kidneys? How do you support your lymphatic system so that they can cleanse the body, manage and detoxify from all the excess acid created by things like estrogen, which is quite acidic in comparison to progesterone, so that you don't get that acidosis? All these things that doctors just don't have a clue about. I'm sorry to say, they don't, and it's not their fault unless they learn it, because they haven't been taught to begin with. But look at how interesting it is that our body, we have so much control. And again, it goes back to that power. The more you learn, the more you apply, right? And what applies to you now, it's great. It's very powerful, because you're actually realizing that you're getting into this new phase of your life. And yeah, so I think it's brilliant, you know, what you're doing. And sure, you had to go through that dark period again, through everything. And I think the coincidence of the time, menopause and COVID, of course, like, couldn't come at a worse time to go through them simultaneously.
Well, I think my lower self, or the lowest vibration version of myself, I think we can all find that person within us when we're stressed and throughout times like this. I could just say, I'm fat again, and I'm going grey because I've stopped putting these. How did I suddenly turn into this overweight, grey, angry person that I didn't want to be, who's stressed all the time, who's not dealing? Madam, take a breath. Reconnect with the highest, or the highest version of yourself that you can find today, and just remember who you are. And a lovely lie that a friend gave me, and this was way back in, this was March 2020. I remember lying on some kind of blow-up bed on the fake grass in the back tiny yard of the tiny rental that we were in. And I just didn't want to be lying on rubber on fake grass. Anyway, it was the way that I could just enjoy the sun at the time. And I was on the phone to my friend, literally releasing and ranting, because until this point, I had complete control of my life. Everything was happening. Everything was just getting better and better, with with Explore Raw, with my new, at the time, then fairly new relationship when we met each other. We're old school sweethearts slash friends who, when we reconnected as later adults, when we were 47, we just knew that we'd be getting married. So everything was just moving along in a certain lovely direction. And then everything stopped, and it was nothing that I could control. And it was infuriating. And I think I was part of the mind explosion for me. You could never say it's any one thing. As you say, menopause, getting married more than once to the same person and all the admin around that. May sound silly now, the whole experience of lockdown, and I think, well, hang on, I've got a beautiful house, you know, 200 miles away from me, and this house we've got nothing, you know. And a friend, I was thinking, oh, I've got all this time to grow stuff and get, you know, start planting. Well, why should I plant in a house that's, you know, a temporary rental? And a friend who I was sharing all my rants with had basically said, look, thrive where you've been planted, just right now, just be thriving. And my head really just rejected, my lower self just rejected this expression. Ah, it's all right for you because you're in your house and you can. And just literally my head was all over the place. But what an amazing thing to share. What a lovely lesson, because something that I'm trying to do every day was not everything out in the world there is right. Not right. Everything. Most things I can't control. Not everything is right or can I control in my inner world. But today I choose to thrive and to thrive in this situation that I've been planted in, because it's the ultimate lesson. And maybe that was my dark night of the soul, that I don't have control, you know. As a single successful woman in business who had kept a roof over my head, paid off her mortgage, and I ticked all of those boxes and I was in control. And then life said, okay, so you think you're in control. Well, here we go. Get ready for the ride. So for me, that, again, this is something new that I'm taking into my mid-50s. And I can't even believe that I'm saying that out loud, like most of us do when we're starting to age. We're trying to get a grasp of it. Is that what now? How can I best thrive in this situation? Again, physically, mentally, spiritually, practically. I'm looking out the windows in the conservatory here at my garden. How can I help this place thrive to serve me best so I can serve others best? So that's something that I'm really taking on board.
I love that. I love that. And big lesson for everybody. Like, we don't have control, but we can be present in the moment and deal with what we have at our hands. And I think, you know, I personally, you know, I say this with confidence and believing it. It doesn't mean I get it right all the time. Sometimes I do get into that lower state of vibration. And I, especially when the weather is not good or when I'm going through my cycle, I can get quite bugged down and think about these negatives. And of course, they're not productive. And, you know, and I can go back and reminisce, like, you know, oh, when I had a job, I used to make so much money and I was so, you know, and of course, when I left banking, actually,
I had a dental plan. I had one.
Exactly. Like, everything was really so easy, like, in a way, but it wasn't like I wasn't happy anyway. So going back and reminiscing these things, one has to be realistic about why did you actually leave? You were not happy. If you had been happy, you would have stayed. But also, I guess because in London, I had such a community in a way, like, it wasn't perfect, but because I started doing what I was doing very early, like, I, you know, I was doing events, it was easier. Like, I managed them easier. But and so when I compare to like Portugal, where I don't speak the language enough to actually do workshops in Portuguese, nor do I really want to, and in Portuguese, and where I don't have the network and it's harder. And, you know, we are in the north. We're not like Lisbon is more like London now, which is not necessarily good, actually. But, you know, it's different dynamics. I have to really check myself and be like, where am I right now? What are my blessings? And what am I grateful for where I am right now? Because I can go down that really dark path of comparing my life to London, like comparing to what it would be if I lived in like Lisbon. But where I am is where I chose to actually be, in a way, like, not necessarily Portugal, but let's just say in nature, is what I chose to be here. And I knew that that would come with disconnect from the city. And what everything, the conveniences of the city, and that's okay. Like, so how am I going to thrive best in this, you know, environment and in this in the situation that I actually created because I wanted it. So when you're in low vibration, you forget even your why sometimes, because that negative, and it's the ego, you know, because the ego is so comfortable in negativity in a way, because it thrived in knowing that, like, I was doing great things when I had this and that, and the ego was boosted up, and now the ego is like, I got nothing.
Talking of ego, I mean, you know, my ego in business was very well boosted because I was really was at the top of my game,
yeah,
and fantastic salary, doing wonderful things. And when I was doing Explore Raw, when I was really running with Explore Raw, which was everything raw, wellness and foodie, everything. I mean, you know, I had publishers asking me, are you going to write another book? Can you write a book? I mean, it just doesn't happen. I was just really, it was a wonderful ego boost, everything that I achieved. And I suppose the lower vibration is that, I remember it took me about a year, I think, to switch my website off, a year into the pandemic, because part of my ego, well, people need to see something from me. And I thought, well, what the hell do I show? Because at the time I was, you know, clothesless, Wi-Fi-less, fridge-less, washing machine-less, the little things that you need in life, not in a place where I felt I was able to thrive. And I thought, well, what do I do? You know, I don't have the technology to do the only time we'd pick up Wi-Fi was we'd go to my husband's mum's house and sit outside in the car with the windows up, and she'd sit on her doorstep to chat, and she'd bring us Sunday dinner in the car, and we'd use her Wi-Fi on an iPad to watch a movie. I thought, well, I can't run a business, but I can't share this. Perhaps overall on the understanding and the reflection, now that was absolutely the stuff to share.
Yeah.
But I never, my ego couldn't handle it, that suddenly now, you know, I had zero income coming in for way longer than I'd expected. So my mind failed, you know, I don't have a financially successful business anymore. There was nothing that I wanted to share. I felt embarrassed to just be, you know, well, I really got my juices. So what am I sharing? And it's because I was stuck in my formula of how I'd been doing it before. I wasn't able, or didn't feel comfortable, thrive. I wasn't able to thrive where I'd been planted. I wasn't doing it. I was, what's the opposite of not thriving, but not failing, not dying, but I wasn't thriving. And that was a situation that I didn't feel comfortable sharing at all, because I'd never had to share things that weren't going right or that I wasn't in control of. I'd never been able to do it. I don't even still think now that I can. But, and so every month I was still paying. I had a marketing list of 25,000 people on my newsletter subscriptions, which is huge. It's fantastic. But I didn't have anything to sell. I didn't have nothing to say. I didn't feel I had anything to communicate. And I was also paying for my monthly subscription with a nothing salary. So it just made sense, without any huge fandango, just to switch it off and just give myself that pause, because I felt I was having to tread water and find something to say and keep this business going, where I didn't even know where my head was at the time.
Yeah. Wow. Well, you know, Steph, I don't know. I mean, I'm seeing something from what you're talking about. I see that, I don't know if it's going to be Explore Raw, called Explore Raw, but there's something you're going to have to start doing, because I think the journey you've been through, oh, maybe it is still Explore Raw, but, you know, I think there is so many lessons here that people really need to hear. And maybe canceling that mailing list, because I know by accident you actually deleted everything.
I know, yeah.
but maybe that wasn't actually an accident.
Yeah.
That maybe was because you need to reach out to new people. People that get that.
I did a wonderful mini workshop in my kitchen a couple of weeks ago with some new friends in who have a vibe very similar to mine, who do lots of foodie things. And I feel like I'm really able to reach out and connect to a bigger, broader tribe here. What am I trying to say? A lot of my network now, kind of, because I've not lived here for many years, is quite alien to me. We're still in the rugby playing, the rugby groove, because my husband's a former rugby player, used to play for Wales, and my stepson currently does play. So our life is rugby and sport, which is Fantastic. But I also want to get in more stuff around me, my yoga, my retreat type stuff, all the things that bring me joy, bring those back into my life. And I did a little micro workshop in the kitchen, and I did very little preparation because it was all natural conversation. It was fantastic. So I'm definitely not finished with all of the raw stuff, but you're right. It won't have the look and feel that Explore Raw has always had, and whether it will still be, I don't know, but something is definitely emerging for sure.
Yeah, I sense that too. Wow. Well, Steph, thank you so much for the wonderful goodies that you shared and for being also so open and honest about your journey and your struggles. I truly appreciate it because I feel like, you know, we all need to know that we're not alone when we go through something hard. And this is such a good thing to see that even someone that felt like, okay, I'm on top of my game, can feel low, but then pick themselves up again. That's life. And, you know, we have to be realistic about it. Because as you said, people really just look at the highlights and the real, you know, and then they forget that in between those, there's such a struggle, you know, and that's life happening. The reality is there's a lot of problems and adversities, and we have to face them. And that's
these have been a hard few years. And I know lots of people who've come out of these last few years financially very successful, but in other ways beaten, just completely beaten. And without any judgment on anyone and anyone else on this planet, one of the things that I am so proud of is that I didn't succumb to medically choosing something that I really did not want for me. And without judgment, because we've all been placed in a situation of complete and utter fear. We've had to take decisions around what we want in our body based on so many different things, but also so many things we were told were a choice for us that are not really the case. For example, permission and ability to travel. So it may sound like nothing, but for me, it's massive. I am so glad that that's a road that I didn't go down. But for my long-term medical and mental health.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much. I really appreciate your time. And
my pleasure, anytime. We'd love to do it again. Take care of yourself.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much, Stephanie, for being on the show. And thank you, everyone, for staying on. I hope you really enjoyed the conversation, the open-hearted conversation. We both shared really what is close to our hearts, and I really hope that is resonating with you guys. And if you're going through a hard time, you're not alone. And if you need support, you can reach out to any of us. We are always here to share and help. And it's really all about being on a journey and being open to everything that comes through it. We don't get it all 100%. It's not always perfect, and that's okay. We're humans. We're not meant to be perfect. So I really hope that this encourages you not to give up on your health. Even if you've fallen off the wagon a little bit, get back onto the best things you can do for yourself. Little habits, one at a time, one day at a time. And I promise you, things will change for the better. All right, if you like this episode, please do like it, share it, review it, help us grow, and I'll see you next week. Bye.